Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Will to Love group and is part of the Education in Love series. In the How I Feel About Change presentation, Jesus encourages us to consider the necessity and desirability of eternal change in our lives. How we really feel about change and growth. What is going to change if we embrace love? And introduces the four reasons why we resist change. Recorded on the 20th of February 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Okay. Looks like some have been fed and watered, but they've also disappeared. something's happened there. 20 minutes, not long, is it? Got to be smart about it. Yeah. Okay. All right, I reckon I'm doing pretty good time-wise so far. Have to give myself a pat on the back there. Well, this next session is about how you feel about change. So we're basically asking the same question that we asked about love, but this time we're asking it about change. Now, with both of these questions, there will be many months of work for you. You can see that, can't you, just even with this morning session? If you sincerely work your way through that, that's going to help your relationship with God immensely, but there's going to be many months of work, having to work your way through the family of origin emotions, how that's impacted upon your relationship with God, separating your relationship with God from your relationship with your family to a degree, so that you can work your way through your family stuff and not impose that stuff upon God. This is a very similar thing in that it's going to take quite a few months of your work to sincerely work through the question. But what we want to do today is give you a basic start on it. Does that make sense? Imagine for a moment that you've just given birth to a baby, and as you ladies who have given birth to babies know, they're pretty high maintenance, aren't they? So you've got to do everything for them. You've got to nurse them, you've got to feed them, breastfeed them, or and eventually as they grow, feed them some solids eventually. And, you know, obviously you've got to change their nappy or however other way you catch the excrement and other things that come out. And you've got to do this in a way, in an organised fashion for the care of the child, don't you? So imagine now the child's 1 year of age and still breastfeeding and no solids. You're still having to do the, you know, the nappy and everything, or whatever it is that you use to do those things. And then imagine 3 years of age, still breastfeeding, still having to do the nappy, still having to do the, you know, look after where all the excrement and everything goes. And then imagine now it's 5 years old, still breastfeeding. And still managing the nappy situation, and they still go and point, you know, ga-ga, goo-goo, and no talking or anything like that. Imagine that. And then imagine, by what stage do you start to get worried? Imagine they're 10 years of age and they've still got a nappy on, and they're still being breastfed. Oh, that's a terrible thought. And then, you're still having to, you know, tidy up the waste and everything. And they still can't talk. They still can't do anything for themselves. And imagine they're 15 and they're still being breastfed. Now, at what stage do you start to worry? I'm sure most of you, by the time they're about three, would probably be starting to worry, right? That actually there's no change happening here. There's no growth. And this is a problem. This is a big problem. And in fact, the majority of people, by the time a child's 3 years of age, if there is no change or proper growth, they take them to the doctor, they try to work out what the causes of those particular problems are and try to work through what the solutions are to how allowing the child to grow and change, to enjoy, eventually become a self-sufficient being and enjoy its own life. Isn't that not true? Okay. Well, the majority of you are still in nappies, still breastfeeding, and still want somebody else to do all the tidy up for you. And you are refusing to change. And refusing to change is a major problem, right? Because if you don't change, you can't grow. So it's a big problem. So what I would like to suggest to you is that you look forward to your child changing, don't you? When you give birth to a child, you're not thinking that child's going to remain like that, a helpless individual for the rest of its existence, are you? You're imagining all of the different things that might engage in its future life, all of the different things you can share with it and show it, and all of the different things that it will surprise you with by engaging through its own aspiration, aren't you? When you have the child, generally. And yet, what happens? What age does that stop? Well, for the majority of us, it stops around 20, 25. We stop. We stop changing. We stop growing. Why is that? That's a good question, isn't it? Why is it? You see, God has created you to change forever. Very basic truth. God's created you to change forever. But you know, before the age of about 20, 25, we actually enjoy changing. We do. We look forward to our future generally. We like changing. We like to grow. We like to experience new things. We have generally a bit less fear and so forth. But what happens after then? What goes on inside of us that causes us to believe by the time we're 60 or 70 that, well, I'm old now. No, I don't need to change. I don't even want to change. Why don't I want to change? Because I've realized that I've got a semblance of comfort. I'm now meeting almost all of my addictions, particularly in the Western world, now meeting almost all of your addictions. And you know, we want to stay there. We want to stay in that place. And that's a huge problem, isn't it? Can you see that? Like, from God's perspective, that's a terrible problem. So this is why we need to ask ourselves how we feel about change. The majority of us do not appreciate that change is forever necessary. We don't. We have some kind of goal situation where we believe change will be okay to a certain point. Right? And then once we reach that point, then we've got what we want. And after we've got what we want, we don't feel like we want to do anything other than that. And this is not what God wants for you. God wants you to continue growing, continue growing, continue growing, continue changing, continue changing, continue growing, and continue growing and changing. And who knows what the end of that might be. Like, there's people in the spirit world, particularly in the celestial heavens, still wondering about what that might be, what the end result might be, the power of the individual might be, and what the end result might be. It might even be that you can create universes after a while, who knows? But at this stage, we don't really know the full extent of what the human soul has a capacity to do while it's receiving God's love. But one thing we do know is if you stop changing, you stop growing. Stop changing, you stop growing. Yep. Now, if I am going to be able to receive education from a source that's higher than myself, can you see that I must learn that I'm going to have to change? And change is inevitable, in fact. I'm going to have to learn that basic fundamental fact. And then I've got to ask myself the question, how resistive am I to change? Now, I feel many of you over the last 6 years have proven to me how resistive to change you are. You're very resistive to change. Yep. And that has to change. If you're ever going to experience the happiness and joy that comes from your relationship with God and getting it, and even if you're ever going to get an education in love. So what I would like to do with you in this session is do a very similar thing to what we did in the last session that we talked when we talked about love, how I feel about love. I want you to think about what you feel about change. What are your true feelings about change? Now, you're not going to be able to feel all those feelings. It might take you months to feel those feelings or even years to feel some of those feelings. But at least if we can identify some of the feelings that you're going to need to feel, at least you'll have more awareness of what needs to happen. Because your resistance to change is immense. It's like a mountain. And so we need to analyse the emotional reasons why we have such a high level of resistance to change. Okay, so what are the reasons? You tell me. If we just start and we just, what we'll do with both is feed the microphones just from the back all the way down one at a time until I'm exhausted the situation. So fire away.
Oh.
Sorry.
If I'm resistive to change, it's because I feel that things are quite comfortable now and they can't possibly get any better.
Okay, so there's two aspects there, isn't there? I've got a degree of comfort that I do not feel will be able to be improved upon. So what's that? It's basically saying nothing's better. It cannot get better than what it is, right? So there's nothing better. And that is really a belief, or you could call it even a faith of some kind, isn't it? Yeah. Yep. So pass one along, and who are we over? Gary?
Change is going to cost me something. I'm going to lose something through the process.
Yeah, so what is the cost of change? That's a fear thing for me, isn't it? I'm going, I got things like this. If I change and this drops out of my life and that drops out of my life and this drops out of my life's going to get worse, huh? So I can't do that.
I'm exhausted and I cannot change again.
Okay, I've already done too much changing.
Yeah.
Why does change exhaust us? It doesn't exhaust us when we're a child. In fact, we enjoy it. It's funny, as an adult it exhausts us, but when we're a child it doesn't exhaust us at all. Isn't that interesting? So that tells me there's addictions, right?
I know what I know, but I don't know what I don't know. So that's also fear-based.
Let's just put it basically, I'm scared.
Yeah.
I'm scared of what the future holds, what it might tell me, all these different things. Who's on this side now? Where are we up to here? Yep.
I think it's scared as well, but it's risky.
Risky, yeah, very good. So there's a difference between risky and scared, isn't there? Risky. There's a certain indeterminate factor with riskiness, isn't there? It's like, who knows what will happen? It might be a disaster, right? And usually that's the way we think, isn't it? We don't ever think it's going to be a fantastic, wonderful thing. We think it's just going to be a disaster. Nina.
Another fear-based one. I don't mind the change as long as I can control it. And
take it off in
measurable chunks.
Yes, I have to be able to control change. Yeah, it has to be controlled. Can't ever be something that's uncontrolled.
A fear of attack.
I'm afraid of getting attacked. Let's put it like that, fear of attack. In other words, you fear that other people, how other people will respond.
Correct.
To your change.
Yes.
Yes.
Specifically about myself.
But specifically who?
Specifically about myself, like
they'll respond to you as a person.
Correct.
If you change,
like
yes?
If I don't continue as
yep.
I am.
Yep, no, that's good. Who we got over here? Oh, we're down to where?
Fear of the unknown.
Okay, I'm afraid of the unknown. Everything's unknown. By definition, that's true, isn't it? Like, Like, does a little child know what it's like before it walks, what it's going to feel like to actually learn to walk? Of course it doesn't. It's unknown, right? While you may know it because you've gone through it, the little child doesn't know it, hasn't gone through it. So by definition, everything's pretty much unknown, and yet we're so frightened of it. And yet it's a fact of life, isn't it? Most of the things in the world, in the universe, we still don't know. So, and yet we're so hung up about that. Yeah, who are we up to over here?
I was going to say unknown, but it's also like the overwhelm of the unknown.
Okay, it's going to stretch me so much. I'm going to feel terrible. Isn't it? Like feeling overwhelmed is the good word. Yeah, I'll be overwhelmed. Okay, yep. Anything else? Who are we going across to? Yep. Pitch. Here we go.
That change will be extremely painful.
Yes, painful. Pain is the only, do you think the little child goes, it's going to be so painful learning to walk. I don't think I'm going to do it. You imagine it's like, so you're 15, 18 years old and you're this... crawling around on your hands and knees, and somebody says to you, why are you crawling around on your hands and knees? Learn to walk, it's painful. It's too painful for me. Who are we over here, Lorna?
Unstable.
Unstable? In what regard? Have you got any specific regards that you feel it's unstable?
Well,
by definition, change means unstable. But
well, I think it's because I'm uncertain, I don't know. And I'm used to what I have decided.
But you're not holding the mic and nobody can hear you.
I'm sorry.
Go.
I'm used to knowing whatever I know, even if it's terrible, because I know it. And when I don't know it, I feel really off kilter and unstable.
Yeah, I feel there's a few other things that are there already that describe that. Yeah. Yep. Okay, who are we up to over here? Yep.
That people won't like me if I change.
Okay, so it's a lot about people's opinion of you, isn't it, Phoebe? So what can we say? It's really a fear, again, of a similar thing to that.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah, probably is. Yeah.
So fear of attack, a fear of other people's opinions, but other people
losing the approval.
Losing approval, losing acceptance. What is all of that really? It's losing my addictions being met, isn't
it? Exactly, yeah.
So we could say dropping off or losing addictions. What do we generally feel about our addictions? They're all good, aren't they? Yeah, so they're all good. So when you lose them, that's all bad, right? That's all bad. Yep. Okay, who's next over here? And who's next here? Pam.
My fear of losing, a fear of feeling unsafe.
Okay, yes. So unsafe. We can put in there along with that insecure and so forth, can't we? All of those things to do with safety.
Mine was unpredictable, and that comes into the unsafe.
Yes.
You feel unsafe when it's unpredictable.
Unpredictable, definitely. It sort of mixes into the unknown, doesn't it, when it's unpredictable, I don't know what's going to happen, what's going to finish up. Maurice?
Fear of loss of identity.
Loss of self, yeah.
Loss of self-identity.
Loss of who I am.
Yep.
Right, this is a big one for a lot of people, a lot bigger than what most people... You know, a lot of people refuse to change because they're worried. They think that who they are right now is the best person they can be, and it is the real person they are. And if you change, then you're going to lose who that is, and that's going to be terrible. And everyone around you won't even know you anymore. And you won't even know you anymore. Wow, that'd be confusing.
Fear of having to regret forever having made the change.
All right, so a worry about regret. Yep. Similar feeling to nostalgia in a way, which is a lot about regret. Yep.
Vulnerable, out on a limb. And
yeah, I think that sort of fits in with risky and those kind of emotions, doesn't it? Who we have here, Rory?
Fear of being wrong because other people around have the right to stay in their condition.
Yep. And we could also put in the opposite to that too. a lot of us fear being right as well.
Arrogance, I know it all.
Yes, but I don't know if that's how you feel about change. I think arrogance is just an attitude that we have towards a lot of things.
Probably, is it?
You need to use the mic, Glenn.
Yeah, is it just that? Yeah, got it.
You know what I mean? Like, to me, arrogance is an attitude that you can carry across to almost any part of your life. What I'm talking about here is what are your personal feelings about actually changing. But you could say one personal feeling is, I don't need to change. I'm already perfect. Right?
Was mine. Sorry, that was
yours?
Probably going to be mine.
Yeah, I would put for you though. It's not that you believe you're already perfect. It's just that you believe that you are already the best you could be.
Yeah. Because I want to be so much different to my mother. So.
Yeah. It'd be woeful to be the same as your mother, wouldn't it?
Oh, but I am my mother's daughter, and that's...
Yeah, by the time you're 80, you'll probably look like her and everything. I know that sounds like a joke, but actually it's a very regular thing that happens. And the reason why is we're carrying around the same emotions, generally, emotional injuries, as our parent, and so eventually those emotional injuries have the same effect in our body and the same effect in our face and the same effect on our life as they did for our parents. And as a result of that, we end up oftentimes being the very thing that we're afraid of becoming. Yeah, Dawn.
Change will affect my facades and reveal more facades.
It will do. Why do you feel that's bad?
Because I've put so much effort into the facades that I've created out of control and fear, unknown, risky, scared.
So can we say then it's all about your investment?
My investment of, yep.
Right, whatever those investments are.
Yes.
Right, so in other words, I'm afraid to change because I'm invested in this and I'm invested in that. And it could even be financial investments, because change will also probably trigger a lot of those too. Right, so it could be financial investments in my personality, my facade. It could be quite a lot of different things if you think about it. Right, all right. Well, we could go on for one more for Igor, and then we'll move on here.
Change equals pressure, and.
Yeah, this is something I notice a lot of you do feel like when I raise an issue, you feel like automatically that you're being pressured now to be a different person than you are, right?
Yeah, I want to do it on my own terms.
Yeah, on your own terms, under your own control and so forth. Yeah. Okay. We've got a lot of negative feelings about change, right? Yeah. And if we analyse our own negative feelings about change, I'd be surprised if the majority of you don't come up with a page or two of them. And we just have so many negative feelings about change. We're so frightened of it. And then the next question I'm going to ask is going to make you even more frightened. Because I'm going to ask you, what do you think is going to change? So that's what you feel about change. What do you think is going to have to change? If you're ever going to become one with God, what's going to have to change? let's lump it into everything, but let's be more specific, shall we, as to what's going to have to change. Let's again start at the back, so Josh and with Eloisa, and then we work our way down.
The way that you live your life?
The way you live your life, yes, that's going to have to change. Yeah, most of us live our life out of harmony with love. We're going to have to bring it in harmony with love. We live our work situation, our relationship situation, our friendships, and our, you know, list them all of our different types of relationships we have, the majority of them are all out of harmony with love. They're all going to have to change, which potentially means we may lose them all. Right? So that's a pretty scary concept.
You just covered it. But I can add more.
Sure you can.
my whole perception of everything like that I perceive as real, true, right is going to have to change.
Correct. So perception of what is reality will completely like do an about face, because it'll be God's reality rather than the reality that we have here on earth right at the moment, which is basically humankind's definition of what love should be. And it's going to change into what God's definition of love is. And that reality is like night and day. It's completely different to each other.
Yeah.
Right. So how do you feel about giving up your complete reality? What you believe is real is now going to be look like it's not real anymore. And then a whole heap of things you thought weren't real are now going to appear real to you. And everyone around you is going to believe completely the opposite to that. How's that going to feel?
I feel pretty scared about that.
Yeah.
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 Well, yeah. Sometimes I feel really excited about that.
Yeah.
About the possibility.
Isn't it funny how we go from one swing of the pendulum to the other? Yeah, if you can think about that in isolation, we're normally pretty excited about it. But as soon as you factor in other people's opinions, the world's opinions, how the world would treat you, and all of these other things which you're terrified of, then you go from excitement to dread.
Correct.
Right? And it's interesting that they are sort of two ends of the same pendulum in a way, because dread is a very similar feeling to excitement in some ways, with the exception that it's very uncomfortable in comparison to very nice. So, you know, this is a big problem that we have. We finish up factoring in all of these external factors, and then we go, oh, you know, this is not going to be looking good for me now. So change is going to be a problem here. Yep. Yep. Okay, where are we up to with the other mic? Yep.
The way I manage my life and my time is going to have to change.
Exactly, it does. So the things you spend all your time on the moment, right, is probably going to be completely different after this. Completely different. Okay, Pete.
I'm going to have to stop controlling everything.
Yes, and control is so nice, isn't it? Why do you think it's nice for? I don't understand why you think it's great. What I love is not having to control anything, because it's a very relaxed life. You know, you're not thinking every day. Years ago, like I used to said in other presentations, I used to plan everything for the next day, everything. Man, you know, I'd spend an hour at night planning the whole next day, what could go wrong, what I can do about what might go wrong and everything. Right? Used to write it all down. I have books full of it. Right? Of course, they've all been thrown out now, but I had books of it, right? And the reason why I did that was because basically I was afraid of of losing control of what I thought I had very slim control of in the first place. Yeah. Okay, Chris.
Everything you value, or your values. You know,
yes, all going to have to change.
Your status, your everything.
Yeah. Yeah, think of that. Like you might be well thought of in your community. You might be a well thought of businessman. You might be well thought of amongst your friends. You might be valued by members of your community. And all of a sudden they think you're a crackpot. And now they don't want a bar of you. They don't want anything to do with you, because your opinions vary greatly to theirs, because your reality is completely changed. And so they, of course, no longer can accept your reality, because they wish to continue accepting the world's reality. Yeah. Yep. So as we're feeling about that, we start getting heavier and heavier. It's like, you think about it, if you lived on a desert island, or if we could say a tropical island, that might be nicer. If you lived on a tropical island with just yourself and maybe, you know, your other half, and you already sorted out your stuff with them, so it's really good. And you lived in that isolation, right? And then somebody said, oh, how do you feel about change? I'm sure the majority of you go, yeah, change is good. You'd probably just feel as good about change as you did about growing up, when you were growing up, and how you felt about change. But when you factor in consideration of your friends, your family, your work, your life, your house, your finances, your children, your parents, your society, that, you know, where you live, and then your country that you're in, and you factor in the fact that your change is probably going to have an effect on all of those particular things. How do you feel now? Not so good, right? If we're honest with ourselves, most of us feel basically totally petrified once we factor in those things. Right? And it's interesting that while we consider things in isolation, we usually have less opposition to change than we do when we consider things as a whole. And that tells us our addictions, actually, doesn't it? If you think about it. Our addictions are, we want change to be such that everybody goes along with our change. You know what I learned, as I said to you this morning, very early in my life in the first century, I learned that if I was going to be the same as the world, then that was a huge problem. But many of you want to be the same as the world. You can live in the world but not be of the world. But many of you want to be of the world, because of the world means you get approval, acceptance. You get all the addictions met. When you're not of the world, you don't get those addictions met anymore. And that's what you're worried about, right? And that's one reason why you avoid change. Okay, so here we are. We've got all these feelings about change, which, by the way, portray, do they not, a complete lack of faith in change, which is ironic given the fact that when we were a child we had complete faith in change, complete faith in it, and then we became an adult and somehow we lost any faith in change in that process, which is interesting, right? As a child, and in fact, if a child is growing up, when a child's growing up, even adults have complete faith in change then, which is why the child also has the comfort of having complete faith in change, because they're projected at them from the adults, from the society, is a complete faith in their change, and that it's going to bring about a person who's self-responsible and will enjoy life and have other benefits, right? But as soon as we reach adulthood, we seem to completely remove ourselves from the concept that we can have faith in further change. Right? So this is a problem, right? Because if you want to get an education in love, which actually means you're changing, and you have a complete resistance to change, and you feel very confronted by change, and you're unwilling to process the emotions of change, then of course you're going to have a complete resistance to it. Your resistance is going to be holistic in the sense that it will be, I'm unwilling to change how I look, how I feel, how I think, how I act, what I believe. I'm unwilling to change everything. I'm unwilling to change my life, my circumstances, my situation, my environment, you list everything. And this is the impact that we're having on this planet. We're all unwilling to change so much that unfortunately our entire environment that we're living in is now getting totally destroyed because of our refusal to change. We're going to get to the point, you know, if we're not careful, we're going to get to the point as a human race that we can't even sustain our own life on this planet because we've refused to change. That's how bad it is. We're willing to die rather than change. And to be frank, all of us do die from old age generally, and that's because we're unwilling to change. Laura, thanks. If we have the mic down this direction. It's right up the back at the moment, sorry.
Again, is it about what our parents are projecting at us when we change? Is it linked like the other things about?
I don't think so, Laura, because most parents don't mind their children changing, right? So can we really say that the desire to not change now as an adult comes from our parents? Because while we were children, most of the time we were allowed to change to a certain degree. It wasn't usually imposed upon us that we couldn't change at all. And in fact, a lot of changes were looked for and welcomed by our parents. So when we began to walk, what's the average parent's response to us walking? Oh, it's a celebration, photos, party, whatever, right? What about when the child no longer needs a nappy? Oh, it's like celebration, particularly for mothers who are tidying up after them in many cases because the fathers are off doing something else. And so there's a celebration. What happens when the child goes to school the first time?
But these are all things that the child's gaining independence, which means less of a burden on the parent, which is why my parents are able to celebrate it. Like, now I don't have to do that for her. Now she's nearly out of the house.
I agree. The parents have some, what I would classify as emotional reason for celebrating.
Yeah. the change threatens.
But how does the parent react when a child doesn't learn to speak by the time they're five?
Worried.
Yeah. Why is that? Because the parent knows.
Because it looks bad on them.
No, it's not just because it looks bad on them. I think that's emotions you have, but the average parent would feel that it's bad for the child. They need to learn to talk, right? So you've got to be careful about imposing your emotional beliefs on what everybody thinks about a certain situation. The reality is the majority of people on this planet look forward to their children changing. The average person who's, have any semblance of loving treatment of their child looks forward to their child changing till a certain age. Usually that age is what, about 11, 12? And so the child enters the teenage phase, and then how do the parents feel about the child changing? Now they start opposing it. Now remember, we've said that most of our emotional injuries come from a younger age. Right? So the question then becomes, where does this fear of change come from? Right? There's one thing that happens in a child that it learns very, very soon in its life, and that is, if it does not conform to the society reality, as an adult it will become ostracized and therefore in danger. Right? So as a child, you're allowed to change. You go outside, children are allowed to yell and scream, jump around, do anything they want. But if I yell and scream and jump around, everyone thinks I'm an idiot. Right? Like, my kids are allowed to jump on the trampoline, but when I get on the trampoline, everyone says, what are you doing that for? Why is that? It's because we have this concept that an adult should be a certain thing. We don't have the same concept with children. But that concept has been imposed upon all of society, and all of us have it. We believe that we need to be a certain way. That's our facade. We've become addicted to our facade. Yeah? And the main reason why we are afraid of changing is because we're now addicted to our facade, and the society, we think, likes our facade. And the society approves of our facade, and it's not dangerous for us to be in our facade in society. In fact, it's quite dangerous in this society to be out of your facade. That's the reality. You try it. You get attacked a lot more out of your facade than in it. That's why you want to maintain your facade, right? So a lot of this how I feel about change is about fear. Fear, right, as an emotion. That's what it is a lot about. Our mind willingness to process through certain fears. And particularly fears about how other people think or will act if I make certain changes. It's a major problem. It's a major problem because we cannot grow above where society is without actually entering this state of change, and therefore entering the unsafe, seemingly, condition in our own mind. It's an unsafe condition. And this is why the majority of us resist change. Because we feel change is going to end up in a terrible situation for us at some point, whether that be personal situation or even a collective situation where other people are attacking me en masse. Isn't that the case? Isn't that what we're afraid of? Yeah. Interestingly enough, we're not afraid of that when we're a kid. We're 7 years old, we run around, scream, yell, jump in the pool, whatever, walk around half naked, doesn't matter. Right? We do all of these different things as a child because as a child, it's acceptable. It's not acceptable by society standards as an adult. That's why we're so afraid. Yep. If we just go back to...
Because of all that parental stuff, I feel like it's hopeless.
Yep.
Yeah.
I feel like a lot of people have latched onto this concept that they don't have any faith that change is good. Yeah. And I notice a lot of you don't have much faith that change is good. You sort of see things changing as being a disaster. And I do feel there is a large amount of feelings of hopelessness involved with it. That if you change, your life's only going to get worse. So what's the point of doing it, right? And it becomes more and more firmly fixed the older we become. So this is why you meet 80-year-olds that are like an immovable object, right? On every issue, because they've become so afraid of all the aspects of potential change that now they will refuse to change in any regard, right? And you know, the hard thing for them is as soon as they pass, they're forced into change. And it's a terrible, terrible, terrible traumatic process for them because they've resisted change for such a long period of time, right? You need to come to love change. That's where we need to be in the end. So if we come down to Raj.
Seems to me that the desire for adventure gets taken away through the concept of being confronted by everybody not wanting you to move, to change.
Mm-hmm.
And we drop into a complete sense of apathy, and it's like a prison.
And we think the apathy is a real feeling, but actually it's just an avoidance of fear.
Yeah.
So whenever you feel apathetic, like you don't really care about something, most of the time you've been taught that if you cared about it, something might happen to you, so you better not care about it.
Yeah. It's like a big well.
Yeah.
And drop into it.
Interestingly enough, though, I've asked you how you feel about change and about what's going to have to change, and the majority of us have a lot of very negative emotions about change, right? Can I just read you some other emotions that you could have about change? Excited, happy, grateful, liberated, energized, calm, encouraged, curious, empowered. You could feel those things, which is exactly, if you think about it, what a child feels about most of the changes it makes. And yet we don't. Yep. You know?
I find when I'm looking forward at the changes that I'm going, or suspect that I'm going to have to make in the future, I feel all these... heavy, like, shut down emotions. But when I look back at the things that I have been through, it's like, oh God, I did that. That
yeah,
was so
I'm glad
cool.
That happened.
and you feel liberated.
Yes, that's right. And this is the problem we have, is that we've got so much fear about looking forward. We have very little faith in our future. Very little faith in our future. So what I'd like to do probably now is just raise the four main areas why we have very little faith. We have a lot of problem with change. What do you think those four main areas might be? I've mentioned one already. What was that? Can you remember? Nina, thanks.
A lack of faith.
Lack of faith, yeah. It's a big issue. We don't have any faith in God's goodness. We don't believe God's good and that therefore change would be good. Particularly if we're growing towards God, we're changing towards God, the results have to be good. We have no faith in that at all. It's almost like we believe, no, God's like the devil, and changing towards God is like changing towards the devil, in that everything's going to get worse. That's how we sort of see it. Not that a devil exists, of course, but that's how we see it. We see it is a very traumatic process that we want to generally avoid. So let's list that one first. Our lack of faith. That's a big thing, isn't it? Big thing. We don't have any faith that there is such a thing as positive change, although if we examine our childhood, it shows exactly the opposite of that. Right. So it's something we've come to believe. Yep, Kelly, if we come down to Kel. I'm just going to have a cough.
Resistance to God's truth.
Yep, so let's put that one in. Down here I put it. This is a big thing because, you know, God's truth is that you change, things will grow, things will be better, things will be happier, things will be more content, things will be more joyful, you're going to feel an expanded version of yourself and therefore more power, and you'll have more ability to create, everything gets better. That's God's version. And what's our version? Well, we just saw our version in comparison to that. So obviously there's a lot of resistance to God's truth on this issue of change if we can have a completely opposite version to what God's version is. Right? Yep. Yeah.
No trust in God's laws?
True, we have no trust in God's laws at all. To me, that's also a lack of faith, though.
I keep justifying to myself the fear of being overwhelmed.
So what is that, though? The fear of being overwhelmed?
It's just a fear of not wanting to go there.
Yeah, isn't it really just a fear of emotion?
Yeah, yep.
I might have to cry a bit. To me, it's like, so what? Like, I cry every day. What's the problem with that? Right? But if we are afraid of emotion, even having a cry might be something we do once every 30 years. It's a major trauma that causes a cry, right? And then to feel ashamed and guilt and other emotions, you know? Terrible, terrible things, terrible things. Got to avoid them at all cost, right? Avoid emotion at all cost. Isn't that the way of the world? Yeah. Yep. It's working real well, right? And do they get to avoid emotion anyway? No. So it doesn't even work, does it? And yet our fear of emotion causes us to think, fear, avoid emotion at all costs and you'll have the solution of happiness. It's the solution to making your life miserable, to be frank. But that's what we do. We hold on to emotion and we add another emotion and another emotion, another emotion, another emotion, another emotion, another emotion, another emotion. And by now we're drowning in our unfelt hurt emotion. And we're going, life's really unhappy. I wonder why. And it's all because we didn't want to feel any of it. If you feel it, it goes, it leaves you, it doesn't get carried around with you anymore. It's not like carrying a whole heap of baggage on your back. But we don't believe that. Because we've never even tried it, for most of us. Like I remember when I first began to process my emotions, I was 33 years of age. I hadn't cried since I was 10, right? I had so much sadness, hadn't cried since I was 10. Just crying was a major trauma, right? And then, of course, at that stage, I lost my family, I lost my friends, I lost my religion, I lost a lot of things. All of my worldly goods I lost as well. So you imagine where I was at then, right? That helped me start crying. I was pretty resistive to it before then. And after I started crying, I realized, why haven't I been doing this before? What's my problem? My problem was I was so scared of feeling any of these emotions because of their power. I was so scared of it. And now it's just like another day at the zoo, right? What's the one that's missing? You've seen the notes, so many of you, so what's the one that's missing? Phoebe, if we just go to Phoebe straight.
Fear of action.
Fear of action. Big problem. A big problem. Many of you think that you can guess what the result's going to be if you do a certain thing. But what you don't factor in the fact is that if you do a certain thing in harmony with God's laws, there's a whole heap of positive results that you've never had before. So you never factor that in. So all you do is you look at all the negative things that might potentially happen if you do a certain thing, and then you go, well, there's not much point doing anything. There's not much point taking action. Oh, I might as well leave everything the same as it is. Right? And our fear of action is immense. It's a huge problem. And you couple those two fears together, it's like an immovable object then. If you're afraid of taking action and you're afraid of emotion, there is nowhere to go after that. You are going to remain the same for the rest of your life, for the rest of your existence even, if you don't do those two things. Now, God's going to force some actions on you. You know that? You know what some actions are going to be forced upon you are? Death. Right? Well, no, those kind of things are your own causing. Even in a way, death is your own causing, but it's a natural result where you separate from the spirit and physical body, so that's a natural thing that occurs. Death is going to be something that is going to be forced upon you. So there's a change. Have to get used to that one. Sorry? Where you end up after you die, which you've determined, really. Yeah, but the reality is there's a whole heap of laws established that determine that, right? So where you end up with the eye, yeah, you could, wherever you end up, that's going to be something that you're going to be forced to take action about. Yep. But you know what most of us do? Most of us only act when we're forced to act. This is why governments do things like the Greek government at the moment, right? They're totally bankrupt. They've been bankrupt for many, many years. They're in billions and billions and billions, trillions, I think it is, of dollars worth of debt. And they still want to have a 20-hour working week with nobody really working. I don't know if you've been to Greece, but that's what it is. A lot of the times, everyone wants to just have some fun. And the reality is they want to continue that, and they have a belief in them as a society that they should be able to continue that because they brought democracy to the world, right? But look at the society and look at what's happening to their society as a result. There's now anger, violence, all sorts of things starting to happen as a result of that attitude. But it's still a refusing to change. Still refusing to change. They're getting gifts from other countries which they think they deserve. And they're still refusing to change. Still refusing to change. Right? Is that what you want to be like? Still refuse to change. You get gifts from others. Still refuse to change. Still refuse to change. Man, it's a huge problem, isn't it? Right. So, what we've just covered there in a short summary will be 2 days of our course this week. It'll be Tuesday and Wednesday this week. We'll be looking at those four things. Yeah, obviously, we need to address them because they affect how we're using our will, don't they? If you don't have any faith in something, you're not going to use your will to change. What's the point? If you are afraid of feeling emotion, if you've got to change, you've got to feel emotion to release it. And if you're afraid of feeling emotion and you refuse to feel emotion, you're not going to change. It's a big problem. You're not going to use your will to change. And you need to change in order to get God's view of love. So that's going to be a problem. If you're afraid to take action, as soon as you learn what God's definition of love is and you go, God's definition of love doesn't look too attractive to me. So what I'm going to do is I'm not going to act upon it. Now, many of you have chosen that, right? Not acting upon it. So you go, so what you're doing is you're setting yourself in stone, really, and you're saying, I'm not going to take any action. A person who doesn't take action doesn't change, and a person who doesn't take action is not going to have a changed life. You're going to have the same thing that you currently have. So if you're happy with the same thing you currently have, I would suggest to you, you've got some problems with your own psychosis. Do you understand what I mean? You're psychotic if you think that that keeping your current life as it is the best course of action. Right? Bruce.
If you don't take any action and deal with your through emotions, won't you actually, you will change, you'll deteriorate?
Well, no, if you choose to deal with emotion but don't take any action, then the end result is that you're never going to really do anything with any internal thing that's happened to you. Now, I would say that there's a whole heap of emotion you'd have to feel about why you're not taking action anyway. Does that make sense? Yeah, but I agree, if you refuse to do those two things, your life's going to get immeasurably worse. Measurably worse. Yep. And particularly once you know, because there's a whole heap of other laws that kick in then. Yep. All right. So my question to each of you is this. We've got to focus on working through the emotional reality of change and our own personal resistance to it, and what those particular reasons for our resistance to change are. If we refuse to work on that reality, then we're going to continue to have a worsening condition in our life rather than an improving one. Right. So how you feel about change is going to have a huge effect on your education in love. God can't educate somebody who's refusing to change. God can't educate somebody who's refusing to change either. Why is that? Why can't God educate somebody who's refusing to change? Because they're exercising their will to not change.
Yeah, I would just like to ask if I'm in a huge resistance right now because I have so much trouble with my eyes. If there's...
You're asking a personal question, and that time to do that is in the Q&A next.
Sorry, I was thinking if I disturb, maybe I should go out if I'm...
Why do you need reassurance from somebody, Eva? You can make a choice. It's your life. You can leave, not leave.
Yeah, that's
why do you need the reassurance?
No, I'm sorry. I just wanted to know what was going on.
Yeah.
With my eyes.
Yeah, and you're willing to interrupt the entire group to find out, which is an issue of love.
Yes, that's right.
Yep. Any other questions? Too afraid after that. So can you see the point we're trying to make? Today the point we're trying to make is this. I have certain feelings about love. I need to feel what they are. The way I can do that is by asking myself what I feel about God, what I feel about God's love, what I feel about God's laws, what I feel about anything to do with God. That'll help me identify my family origin emotional blockages. I also, if I'm ever going to have an education in love, I need to analyse how I feel about change. That means feeling the emotions I feel about change and my belief systems about change. And as we've seen, my belief systems about change are pretty negative, right? They're certainly not what I'd classify as Pollyanna feelings, right? You know, positive out there feelings, they are very, very negative feelings. And they all boil down to these particular things that we need to address, which we will spend more time trying to address. But unless you work your way through these things emotionally, we will be together in another 10 years' time and having exactly the same conversation. Now, for me, that would be unbearable, so you probably won't have me up here. You'll have somebody else, right? Because my personal feelings are if I'm not changing, then that is unbearable. It means that I aren't accepting more from the source. I'm not accepting more from God, the source of love, and therefore I'm not changing and I'm not growing, I'm not having the benefits of that. To me, that's an unbearable situation. And unless it becomes an unbearable situation for you, you will accept it. You will. Just like you've accepted it up to now. You'll accept it. Right? And my suggestion to you is don't accept it. And this is why we're going to, on Friday, I think it is, have a conversation with you about pain and pleasure. Because the majority of you ignore your pain. You ignore your pain. You hope for something different, a different outcome, but you continue to ignore your pain. And to me, feeling pain is a motivator. It tells me what's out of harmony with love, right? So what we would like to do now is we'll probably have just an 8-minute break if we can. And then what we will do is we have a Q&A about change. So we can ask questions, if you can ask questions that are specifically about change and your feelings about change and how to feel those feelings about change, that would be wonderful. So let's have a break and come back in 10 minutes past 3:00.